afternoon and welcome to the rally to stop the AIM pipeline and protect natural resources, health, and safety in the Hudson Valley. I'm Paula Clare. I'm one of the seven co-founders of Stop the Algonquin Pipeline Expansion, or SAPE for short. You all know that there's a huge 42-inch diameter high-pressure pipeline being constructed next to Indian Point. And Indian Point is already on two earthquake faults. So we think this is a bad idea. And yes, and we feel that this is an extreme risk to our community and we want it stopped. Under pressure from community groups, our Governor Cuomo has ordered a risk assessment on Indian Point, aim at Indian Point. And things that will be covered are homeland security, the impact to health of people in our area, and the AIM risks to the environment, our natural resources such as air and water. At the same time, the governor did a formal request to the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission to stop construction while this risk analysis was being conducted. However, FERC, the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission, or FERC for short, said no, and construction is ongoing at this time. FERC is the body, by the way, the government body, federal government body that has jurisdiction of all pipelines in the United States. And it's kind of known as a rubber stamp agency because it basically approves just about everything it gets. We have speakers today. Oh, come forward. We have speakers today from important environmental organizations that are working to protest the threats to us and our environment. And we're going to focus on the industrial threats to our health and safety and the enormous risks to our communities. In addition to AIM and Indian Point, we're also going to cover other problems with all gas pipelines, such as toxic emissions, and including carcinogenic and organ damaging pollutants that come from compressor stations and other pipeline infrastructure. I should mention that children are particularly susceptible to these toxic pollutions. We're also going to talk about global warming and the large the amount of methane that is coming from these this pipeline and its infrastructure, and as well as CO2. So methane, by the way, is 86 times more potent as a greenhouse gas over 20 years than CO2. So this is not a bridge to getting off fossil fuels and saving the planet from global warming. It's actually accelerating global warming. We're also going to talk about the widespread use of eminent domain to take people's land for corporate profit. Now I'm going to call upon SAPE co-founder Sue McDonald to introduce our first speaker. Sue?
Barbara Ho is a retired educator. For the past 2 years, she's been the Westchester Volunteer Coordinator for Food and Water Watch. Food and Water Watch is our co-sponsor, by the way. And she's going to be speaking as their representative today. Food and Water Watch is a national organization that champions for clean water and air and for people before profits. She has worked on their GMO labeling campaign, as well as the New Yorkers Against Fracking, and the current national campaign to stop fracking on public land. If you don't know about that, find out. It's really important. She's also joined SAPE's efforts against the AIM pipeline on a number of occasions. She's a very busy woman. And who better to kick off our speeches today but Barbara?
My name is Barbara Howe. I'm a lifelong resident of Northern Westchester.
and I'm a volunteer coordinator for Food and Water Watch in Westchester. Food and Water Watch's mission is to champion healthy food and water for all. We helped win the ban on fracking in New York, and we are now working to stop expansion of unnecessary and dangerous fracking-related infrastructure projects, such as the Algonquin Incremental Market, the AIM pipeline. I am here to publicly demand that FERC, the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission, rescind its March 3, 2015 approval of the AIM gas pipeline project, because siting a 42-inch diameter high-pressure pipeline next to the Indian Point nuclear facility poses an unacceptable risk to the lives and the property of the over 20 million people who are living within a 50-mile radius of it. FERC did not satisfy its legal obligation to ensure the safety of the AIM project. It based its decision to approve the AIM project on the Nuclear Regulatory Commission's faulty analysis of a safety assessment that was prepared by the plant's own operator, Entergy. This emergent safety issue concerns the vulnerability of a gas pipeline, and the properties of a pipeline rupture. The NRC is knowledgeable about nuclear operations, not about technical pipeline dynamics. Nowhere else in the country is a gas pipeline sited this close to a nuclear power plant. An independent risk assessment must be conducted immediately, and construction of this undemocratically approved project must come to an even more immediate halt. As a Food and Water Watch representative, I am happy to see so many people out here today, especially because of how cold it is, because we need a clean energy revolution. Looking to the future, mark your calendars for July 24th and join us in Philadelphia at the Democratic National Convention to rally for a sea change, for an air change, and for a world change to renewables. You can stop by our booth or our website for more information. Again, thank you for coming out today to join us in urging the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission to do what we all know is the right thing. Together we stop fracking in New York, and together we will stop FERC from expanding the AIM pipeline. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome. My name is Ellen Weininger. I'm Director of Educational Outreach at Grassroots Environmental Education, and I am a co-founder of Stop the Algonquin Pipeline Expansion and part of Resist AIM. It is so wonderful. Yeah, give a shout. Yeah. I'm so excited to see all of you here. And I want to especially take this moment to thank Paula Clare, who spearheaded this rally. Where's Paula? Let's give Paula a big shout out. We all are very grateful to her for her hard work in pulling this together, and we're really excited to be here. And I'm honored to welcome to the stage Paul Gallay, the president of Riverkeeper, and I just want to say a few words. There he is. Paul is Riverkeeper's president since 2010, has led the fight in the Hudson Valley against the relicensing of Indian Point's two aging and dangerous reactors. Under his leadership, Riverkeeper has also fought to stop the virtual pipeline of fracked fossil fuels such as crude that snakes through the Hudson Valley by rail, barge, and tanker, and the Pilgrim Pipeline that poses a risk of oil spills to the Delaware and Catskill aqueducts, supplying drinking water to 9 million New Yorkers. Last and most importantly, Paul and Riverkeeper stand against the Algonquin Incremental Market AIM pipeline and the possible harm this pipeline project would create in the region, especially where it would pass next to Indian Point's property and the catastrophic scenario this presents. Paul has called AIM all risk and no reward for those that live in the area and finds it disturbing that a federal regulatory agency that's duty-bound to protect our health and welfare is turning a blind eye toward the project's many pitfalls and dangers. Please welcome Paul Gallay from Riverkeeper.
Thanks, everybody. Amazing that you're out here today. It is really a signal of how deeply you care. And I'm going to say this about four times. I'm going to be done in 5 minutes. I took my hat off, so I'll freeze if I talk any longer than that. But democracy lives, and you are proof of that. This is proof of that. In January 2015, I wrote FERC. You boo when I say FERC, okay? Thank you. And I said, this is crazy. You've underestimated the blast radius if this line goes in around Indian Point. It's 100 feet to the control room. It's 1,600 feet to the reactors. You're using the wrong modeling. You're not coordinating properly with Entergy. You're not coordinating properly with the Nuclear Regulatory Commission. Boo when I say Nuclear Regulatory Commission. Thank you. And they shrugged their shoulders. I've worked for government agencies. I know when they're taking you seriously. They did not take us seriously. I wrote them again in September, and I said, you didn't take us seriously then. You've got to take us seriously now. We brought out the big guns in December. Bobby Kennedy wrote an amazing 6-page letter saying, you didn't take them seriously. Yes, thank you. And you. In the meanwhile, the Attorney General from Massachusetts, as other speakers will tell you, wrote that they don't even need this gas. We don't get this gas, and New England doesn't even need it. So what did FERC do? They ignored us all. You guys are that good. They did a cursory, superficial, dismissive, disrespectful review of the risk of damage from this pipeline when they needed to do the exact opposite. They needed to do a transparent, complete, accurate, inclusive review before they could ever have the temerity to put this pipeline anywhere near that Indian Point plant. What's happened in the 14 months since I first wrote that letter? 14 different accidents, mishaps, and malfunctions at Indian Point, the most recent of which is the most serious internal core damage to the bolts that hold the inner walls to the core of Reactor 2 in the history of nuclear science. 4 times worse than the next worst case of failure of the bolts in the internal walls of the core of the reactor at Indian Point 2. Does FERC care? Yeah, boo and no were both acceptable answers. Thank you. Does NRC care? Exactly. And you know what? Somebody said to me, what are we going to do? What can stop this? You know, we tried reason. We tried democracy with FERC. Democracy lives with our governor. He called for an independent safety analysis, and he promised to do one. So he gets a little bit of a shout out here, and he deserves that. And not so much FERC, not so much NRC. And the simple truth is, the only thing that's going to turn them around, because they are a democracy-free zone, we sued them. We sued them on Monday. 23 different plaintiffs from 4 different states went to the Circuit Court of the District of Columbia, the second highest court in the country, and we sued FERC, and we will not stop until this craziness is reversed. We need less natural gas infrastructure going forward, not more. Everybody, FERC included, probably says, yes, we have to do something about climate change. Yes, fossil fuel is a problem. But do you see them translating that into action? They are doing the exact opposite of what they need to do. So yes, we wrote, and we tried, and we reasoned, and we explained, and now we have sued the bastards, and that is what we're going to continue to do. Thank you very much.
Hi, my name is Jerry Ravnitsky. I'm a co-founder of SAVE. Assemblywoman Sandy Galef has, over the past few years, been a strong voice in opposition to the AIM pipeline project and has supported our efforts through meetings with state, federal, and local officials, with letters, phone calls, and press conferences to draw attention to this dangerous proposal and to put pressure on the various agencies to reconsider routing this hazardous pipeline through Indian Point Nuclear Power Plant and through residential neighborhoods. So let's give a welcome to Sandy Galef.
Thank you so much. The only good thing I can say is you should all be up here. It's a little warmer. Not a lot, but it's a little warmer. It's, you know, this is all about a never-ending policy, program, pipeline, and it just seems like we keep trying to figure out other ways to try to get FERC or the NRC, and the governor kind of, he came along with us, which was great, but it's really been a lot of work, and I just want to thank all of you from the 3 years ago, probably when the first meeting was in Cortland to discuss this pipeline, as well as the partners too, and then with all of the rallies that have occurred, the writing that you have all done, you've just really been great. And of course, today is an example of your courage to come out. I'm surprised the snow is gone, but anyway, it is gone. So. And I'd just like to compliment all the elected officials that have been working on this. My colleague, David Buchwald, from the other district, has been a really, really good partner for us, as well as the Westchester elected officials up in Albany, most of them, not all of them. And I want to do a shout out to Cortland and Peekskill. Has been terrific. I know from Peekskill, the mayor's here, Kathy Talbot's here. From Cortland, Debbie Costello, I know, is here. From the town of Austin, Dana Levenberg, who had been my chief of staff, so she worked on all this, and now she's representing from a different perspective. Catherine Borgia could not be here, but she has been leading on the county level this whole issue, and they've done all kinds of proclamations. Our newest thing now, and I want all of you to let me know what you think I can do. The newest is we're circulating a letter up in Albany to try to get all assembly members and senators throughout the state to sign on to say to FERC, stop business, let Governor Cuomo's independent study review take place, let's find out what it comes up with, and we're hoping to gather a lot of signatures. So if you know somebody that's a senator or an assembly person, call them up and say to go on to Galef and Senator Dabo's letter immediately. We want to get it to FERC. So I just thank you. We are never, never, never going to give up. And, you know, there's going to be a win at the end of the day. Thank you all very much.
Hi, everybody. Courtney Williams from SAPE, Synergy, and Resist AIM. I am a Peekskill resident, and I'm here to introduce our mayor, Frank Catalina, who's been working hard to stop this pipeline from putting Peekskill at risk.
Thank you so much, and I just want to welcome everybody to the beautiful city of Peekskill. I don't want to trash other towns. Town of Cortland got $1.7 million from this group. Yorktown, over $2 million. The city of Peekskill will not take one dime from this group, now or ever. And God knows we need the money, and we are not going to take it. I want to take this opportunity to salute my councilwoman, Kathy Talbot, for taking a leadership role in this fight. And I also want to recognize some of the outstanding citizens of Peekskill, like Nancy Van, who laid down in front of the bulldozer to stop this fight. So, Nancy, thank you for all that you do. I could go on, but the other speakers are much more eloquent than I am. They know the risks, you know the risks. It just touches my heart when people like Regina D'Ambrosio come all the way here from Mayapak, who have no impact by this pipeline at all, just because she cares. Regina, thank you for being here. God bless you all, and God bless the city of Peekskill.
All right, back again. Next, I'd like to introduce Peekskill Councilwoman Kathy Talbot, who has been at pretty much every event that we've held, working with us from the beginning to stop this pipeline. Kathy Talbot.
Okay, got to get this down to my level here. Well, the mayor just welcomed you all to Peekskill and our beautiful and extended Riverfront Green Park. It goes all the way down there, all the way up there. You got to check the whole thing out when it's not so cold. I am really proud to be part of this movement. I remember being at Courtney's house in September 2013, I think, when the room was filled with people to learn more about what we could do to stop this crazy pipeline. And this movement has only grown. There's Resist AIM now. There's lots of different people that are just coming in more and more to the movement. I'm so cold, I can barely talk. But I think that having a good grassroots movement is really what it's all about. And people, look around. I mean, you're standing there in the absolute freezing cold. I think that the bigger thing for Peekskill going forward is really to take a look at stopping the pipeline, yes, but also taking a look at what we're doing in terms of renewables. So that's, you know, I'd like us to have in Peekskill a 10-year plan. You know, have a goal, set a goal, and see if we can reach that moving forward. So that's the kind of thing that I'm working on, and I think we got to keep on fighting and stop that pipeline.
Hi, all. Susanna Glidden, co-founder of SAPE. A little education. With gas pipelines come hideously toxic gas power plants, metering and regulating stations, and compressor stations that push along the gas using giant gas turbines. Dense emissions, invisible except to an infrared camera, pour out of the compressor stations by the tons 24/7, ruining the air we breathe and harming our health. Unless Governor Cuomo and Senator Schumer step up and halt this AIM expansion, unacceptably sited at Indian Point, New York's Stony Point and Southeast compressor stations will be expanded to enormous sizes in AIM this year and Access Northeast next year. Here in Peekskill, we're about a mile away from the Stony Point station, and there's a metering and regulating station nearby which also emits toxic fumes. I live 3 miles from the Southeast compressor, and I have COPD, so I'm dangerously affected by its emissions, especially during extra venting called blowdowns, particularly when the skies are overcast and wind blows from the direction of the station. Spectra still unbelievably refuses to give us notification before these monthly blowdowns, putting at grave and possibly fatal risk those of us with pulmonary and heart conditions, the very young, the elderly, and others with immune deficiencies. Our government is allowing us to be sacrifice zones. We must rise up in mass numbers, reach out to your neighbors and family, take home that small action alert and the fact sheet, and please join us in outreaching Cuomo and Schumer. The DEC must revoke the Title V air permits, or at least modify them to demand that industry installs mitigation technology so that the emissions during blowdowns don't vent directly to the air. Governor Cuomo may have done something that looks good by asking FERC to halt AIM, while New York State at long last conducts a risk assessment, but it's done nothing to stop the project. He could have helped early, as we asked him to, unbridled corruption of our politicians by the influence of corporate money is influencing decisions being made in our state. Please visit dirtyenergymoney.com and check out what your representatives are receiving. And go to our website, sape2016.org, and read the article about how much money from Spectra went to Cuomo and the other companies that went to Cuomo for the other two big projects in the state. Join us and insist that he protects us and not corporate profits. Americans' awareness is growing across the country against the grip of this oligarchy. Please make a commitment today to be an active part of our movement to bring about a change. The Millennium Pipeline brings Pennsylvania frack gas into the Algonquin Pipeline at Ramapo. Here next to speak about her terrible experience with the Millennium Pipeline's Minisink compressor station and the coming CPV gas power plant is an activist we greatly admire, Pramilla Malick.
We say no! 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 Thank you all for inviting me to be here with you today on this cold and foretelling day. You know, when you have a snowstorm in April just 2 days after it was 80 degrees, you must understand that Mother Nature is trying to tell us something. Yeah. I'm often referred to by the gas industry as an alarmist mother, but if you listen to the winds howling this morning, then you heard an alarm that must not be ignored. The alarm of Mother Nature. And if we don't listen to what she's telling us through the extreme weather, through the dying pine trees, through the disappearing bats, through the howling April winds, as many scientists have warned, she will survive, but we will not. It's ironic that all this frack gas infrastructure is being built at lightning speed in order to, as we keep being told, to keep the lights on. So it's ironic that on this day, we have over 100,000 homes in the U.S. without power as a result of climate change weather events. And we keep building more methane-leaking pipelines, compressor stations, and power plants to sustain more methane-leaking fracking wells. This is irrational. When we know that methane has 86 times the global warming potential of CO2. And indeed, we are now all living in an era of methane madness, methane mania. And just like the fog of war, make no mistake, we are living in a fog, and we are at war, and there are casualties. Yeah. The fog is fracked oil and gas. The casualties are communities like yours here in Westchester and mine in Minisink, under siege by ever-expanding gas infrastructure, invaded and occupied by companies like Millennium Pipeline and Spectra Energy. As they march on to power plants and LNG ports, leaving a wave of destruction, fractured forests, spoiled soil, dried wetlands, families forced to flee like my neighbors up the road, and those left behind who suffer in silence with symptoms that show the marks of methane invasion, especially on the bodies of our children, with nosebleeds and headaches and rashes, just like the children of Minisink, like my own daughter, or the families of Aliso Canyon in California. Aliso Canyon is now considered an environmental catastrophe worse than the BP oil spill. But when you build thousands of miles of frack gas pipelines, hundreds of compressor stations, and over 300 frack gas power plants, you are creating a multitude of Aliso Canyons all over the country. And that's exactly what we're doing today. It's a slow but sure, insidious, and continuous environmental catastrophe in the making. And you want to know the biggest April Fool's joke of all? It's all being done under the name of fighting climate change. And it's called the Clean Power Plan, which I call the Frack Power Plan. Now, many people point the finger at FERC, and Minisink was the first community in the country to confront and challenge FERC over 4 years ago. We were the first to protest FERC, the first to call it the rogue rubber stamp machine that it is. But when we followed the infrastructure trail from FERC's headquarters in Washington, guess where it led us? It led us to our own state capital. Because downstream of every pipeline and compressor station project is a frack gas power plant. And every power plant is entirely state approved. And that means pipelines, because the gas is not going to get there by FedEx. And no governor, including our own banned fracking governor, is free from culpability in this cynical scheme. Millennium Pipeline, which goes through Minisink, as Susanna said, connects to the AIM. Now Millennium has just announced a new expansion, which many believe is to feed the new power plant being built by Competitive Power Ventures, just 30 miles from here in Orange County, which Josh Fox calls the power plant that's going to put New York City underwater. And if you look downstream of the AIM pipeline, you'll see that there's another CPV plant being built in Oxford, Connecticut, also approved by their governor, and so on down the line. And all of these projects are interconnected, and all are needed for the methane machine to function. So we're not going to win. We're not going to truly be frack free until we shut it all down. Shut it down. Shut it down. Shut it down. Shut it down. And we work together, upstream, midstream, and downstream, with one unified voice, because we're all connected by these pipelines that poison us. We're connected by the air we all breathe, the water we drink, and the food we eat. But most importantly, we're connected by our common humanity and our hope for our children to not just survive, but to thrive. Our national and state energy policy right now is like a two-lane highway, and one lane represents public health and the other climate change, and we're speeding down that highway at 100 miles per hour, and we keep being told there's a bridge at the end of this road that will finally take us to a sustainable future, but we're actually headed off a cliff because that road is paved entirely with frack gas. And the bridge is an illusion of the fog. We must realize that just like Dorothy, if we click our heels three times, we're already on the other side. No need for any bridge. One click for wind. Yeah. One click for water power. Yeah. And one click for solar. Yeah. And just like Dorothy, we must realize that we, not the politicians, not the industry, we have the power, and we had it all along. Thank you.
Shut it down.
Hi, guys. We're not just going to shut the pipeline down, we're going to shut FERC down. Pramilla said that, was talking about how many people are without power today because of climate change. Well, we don't have to go out to the West Coast to find that. 3 miles that way, my community doesn't have power today because of this terrible weather. This winter has been one of the warmest ever recorded. Climate change is not something that's coming, it's something that's here. And the handmaiden that's delivering climate change to us is FERC. Our Boo is right. Our community and our good friends at Riverkeeper, Food and Water Watch, and Stop the Algonquin Pipeline Expansion have filed a lawsuit in federal court on Monday to try to challenge this pipeline. We know what was illegal about it when it was first being considered for its environmental impact statement, but since it's been being built, there are more and more things that have been done that were not in the environmental impact statement. There's more areas that have been taken. None of this was considered. And of course, there are two more pipeline expansion projects that are following right along on the very same pipeline that was illegally segmented. I'm introducing a really wonderful woman who has come all the way here to talk to you a little bit about another litigation that they are filing from the Delaware Riverkeeper Network. Their litigation doesn't just challenge a pipeline, it challenges the whole pipeline infrastructure build out. I'll let her do most of the talking about that, but FERC is an agency that doesn't listen to people, doesn't hear our comments, doesn't have a public comment period when their commissioners meet. So we don't know that they even know what's going on where these pipelines are being built. I'm a little sore today still from where I tried to tell them about Governor Cuomo's letter, and they dragged me out of the FERC meeting about a week and a half ago. So I am really, really proud to introduce Maya Van Rossum, who is the riverkeeper for the Delaware Riverkeeper Network. That network was established in 1988. It's a nonprofit that is organized to protect the Delaware River, which provides drinking water for 17 million people. Maya has been the riverkeeper there since 1994, which is before a lot of you were born. She's also and you wouldn't know it to look at her, no. She's also an attorney that's admitted in 3 states and as an adjunct professor. And I could go on for the entire time that she is allotted to speak with all of the wonderful honors and all of the accomplishments that she's made. But I think you'd probably rather listen to her than hear about everything that she's done. So here you are, Maya Van Rossum.
Let's hear it for Nancy. Woo! She's done so much good for so many, and we're so honored to have her as part of our community battling pipelines. And as Nancy said, and as many of the speakers have said, and will say, and as my son's sign here says, FERC doesn't work. FERC doesn't work. FERC doesn't work. FERC doesn't work. FERC won't work for us until we make FERC work for us. So that's what we're here about today. That's what we're doing across pipeline battles across the nation, is we're fighting to make FERC work, and to make FERC work for us and not for the pipeline industry. You know, back in the 1980s, FERC lobbied to be funded by the pipeline companies and the other industries that it's supposed to regulate. And in 1986, it got its wish. And ever since then, FERC has been bought and paid for by the pipeline industry, doing their bidding at every turn to harm our companies, or to harm our communities, to help the pipeline companies. FERC doesn't work. FERC is the epitome of a rubber stamp. In 30 years, FERC has denied one pipeline project in 30 years. And that rejection, that first rejection in 30 years, came just 2 weeks ago. And why did it come 2 weeks ago? It came because of all of the pressure all of us across the nation battling these pipeline companies are bringing to bear on that horrible agency doing so much damage to so many communities. FERC does not hold the industry, the pipeline industry, accountable for their violations of law. FERC regularly turns a blind eye to violations by the pipeline industry that happens during construction, during operation, and during maintenance of their pipeline projects. As far as we know, FERC has never issued a single penalty against a pipeline project for their violations of law. They don't even issue stop work orders to force those pipeline companies to come into compliance with the law, to clean up their polluting messes before they continue business as usual. And you know, the fact of the matter is, why would FERC punish the pipeline companies for their violations of law, when at FERC itself, manipulations and violations of law are business as usual? FERC routinely allows projects to go into construction without having all required permits from all required agencies. It is standard operating procedure at FERC to strip people like us of our right and our ability to challenge pipeline projects in the courts before FERC allows them to go to construction. It is business as usual for FERC to strip states of their right to deny pipeline projects before FERC allows those pipeline projects to go into construction. It is routine for FERC itself to manipulate and violate the law. FERC doesn't work. And while FERC has not spent one penny of its fast exploding and now $300 million budget to help people participate in its public process by funding an Office of Public Participation, FERC routinely invests very heavily in defending its own bad behavior and in defending the rights of the pipeline companies with these awful pipeline projects that are inflicting so much damage. And so we are here today with regards to the AIM project, with regards to pipeline projects across the nation, to draw a line in the sand. We are here to say we don't want the devastating cuts these pipelines leave through our communities, the indelible scars they inflict upon us all. We don't want to force our communities to live next to the hazards of a pipeline, to the reality and the possibility of accidents, incidents, and explosions that they bring. We don't want the threat of a nuclear catastrophe that the AIM pipeline could bring to our communities and to our nation. We don't want the pipelines that will take our front yards, our backyards, our public parks, and our peace of mind. We don't want the climate instability that these pipelines inflict upon us with their greenhouse gas emissions. We don't want the water pollution, the air pollution, the lost forests, and the lost wetlands that these pipeline projects inflict upon us. We don't want the harm to farming and businesses of all kinds that these pipelines bring to our communities. And while FERC may be bought and paid for by the pipeline industry, we have rights, and we know we have rights, and we are here today to exercise those rights. And we are defending our rights from FERC. We are defending our rights against the pipeline companies. We are defending our rights in the hearing rooms, in the courtrooms, in the streets, and in our own backyards. We are doing what we have to defend our rights from FERC and from the pipeline industry. And there are many of us defending our rights in many different ways. We can win against FERC. We know we can win against FERC because we have won against FERC. In 2014, the Delaware Riverkeeper Network won a piece of litigation against FERC. In the District Court of Columbia, the Circuit Court, three judges said FERC violated the law when it approved the Northeast Upgrade Project. They violated the National Environmental Policy Act, and they were said to go back to the drawing board. Unfortunately, the pipeline was already built because FERC doesn't work, because they stripped us of our right to go to court to battle back that pipeline project, to challenge FERC until it was too late. So by the time we won this incredible precedent-setting victory, it was too late. The pipeline was built and it was in operation, and all of the damage and devastation had already been inflicted. And so that is why we have brought a new piece of litigation. We have brought a piece of litigation that challenges FERC's entire process as violating our constitutional rights to due process under the law. And we are going to beat FERC. We're going to beat FERC for the AIM pipeline, for the Millennium pipeline, for the PennEast pipeline, for the Constitution pipeline. We're going to beat FERC back, and we're going to start to win against these pipeline projects so we can get onto the renewable energy that we want and we need for our communities and for our nation, and get away from this dirty, damaging fossil fuels. Thank you all for being here today.
Hi, I'm Amy Rosemarin, and I'd like to introduce Paul Blanch, an independent nuclear expert and registered professional engineer. He's got 50 years of experience evaluating safety at Indian Point and other nuclear facilities. Because of his concern regarding the grave risk associated with the siting of the gas line at Indian Point, he's worked tirelessly over the past 2 years delving into regulation so he can identify and counter the evasive and deceptive statements from the NRC and Entergy. So Paul has been invaluable as he's revealed the unconscionable way that the NRC, PHMSA, and Entergy are misleading the public, misleading federal agencies, and misleading elected officials. And he is relentless in this pursuit. Paul.
Thanks, Amy, and thanks to everyone for coming out here. You know, our previous speaker and all these signs, I haven't seen it yet, and I just thought about it. We haven't got a sign that says, "Fuck you." Yeah. Anyway, I'm not going to be talking about FERC. I'm going to be talking about the danger of those two domes that you see downstream here, and the potential risk of the interaction between this proposed pipeline and Indian Point, and what are the real risks in addition to global warming, but the interaction between the pipeline and Indian Point, and it's cold up here. We have the potential of gas explosions and fires with the energy equivalent of many atomic bombs going through this pipeline, this proposed line, every hour. We have the potential for releases that exceed those of Fukushima and Chernobyl. Nobody, no town, no government, no residents has any insurance to protect you against a devastating accident that has a relatively high probability of occurring. We have the potential of local destruction of the national and the local economy. And as Carl Grossman, an author and environmentalist, recently wrote, this is a weapon of mass destruction. Those two domes down there are a weapon of mass destruction that could cause this area to become uninhabitable for years. While I do have a problem with FERC, I've got major problems with both the Nuclear Regulatory Commission and PHMSA, which is Pipeline Hazardous Material Safety Agency. We have FERC and these agencies doing risk assessment for bats, for snakes, for birds, for turtles, but not for 20 million residents. There is no risk assessment. The law, the federal law, is very clear that risk assessments for people are required. This is under the PHMSA or Department of Transportation regulations. They are absolutely required. We have contacted the Nuclear Regulatory Commission and PHMSA and the DOT, and they say we have the regulations. We have lots of regulations. The problem with these agencies is they absolutely refuse to enforce these regulations. I looked up this morning on the PHMSA website, and it states PHMSA is responsible for regulating and ensuring the safe and secure movement of hazardous materials to industry and consumers by all modes of transportation, including pipelines. They haven't done it. They have the regulations. They refuse to enforce them, just like the NRC. It's not just FERC, it's PHMSA, it's Entergy, it's Spectra, it's the NRC, it's all these agencies that their only goal is to make more money. Sandy Galef, Congresswoman Lowy, Congresswoman Engel, and the governor have pleaded for a risk assessment only to fall upon deaf ears. Schumer and Gillibrand have been silent. They're getting numerous contributions from these energy companies. We get other local enforcement officials who will arrest people for obstructing traffic, but when our federal government allows the endangerment of 20 million people, there is no enforcement. I got to turn my page here. So who is going to enforce this law except for the trespassers? No one's going to enforce this law unless we can get more people like you yourselves out here to get attention to this major problem and these weapons of mass destructions. What can we all do? Again, get out here, make noise. We have a major article coming out tomorrow in a major newspaper, hopefully, and maybe we get more attention. I'll be available later to answer any questions in this cold, cold weather, but again, I want to thank you for everyone coming out in this weather and showing your support for all of our efforts. And thanks again, and frick you. Thank you.
Hey, everybody. I'm Kim Frotchek. I'm the co-director of Sane Energy Project, and I'm also an organizer with Resist AIM. I'm here to introduce one of the most inspiring people I know, Courtney Williams. She lives 400 feet away from the pipeline. She is a PhD cancer researcher. She has amazing artistic children, and Irene and Gunner, and her amazing husband Eric, who's so supportive of us. And she and her family are my inspiration to not stop direct action against the AIM pipeline until we shut it down. Everybody, Courtney Williams.
Thanks, Kim, for the intro. Thank you, everybody, for coming out despite this nasty example of global climate change that happened last night. I am joined here on stage by the children of Peekskill. I live 400 feet from this gas pipeline, and the new pipeline that Spectra wants to build would pass 400 feet from Buchanan-Verplank Elementary School. And I am standing here with two BV Eagles that do not want a pipeline past their school. I am here today speaking to you on behalf of Resist AIM, which is a community of activated citizens that realized all the stuff you heard here today, that FERC doesn't work, that the NRC is asleep at the wheel, that there is nobody watching out for our interests and nobody planning to do the right thing for our community and for our global climate. Resist AIM was formed during the 9 months that FERC refused to rule on our request for rehearing, giving Spectra a 9-month head start on construction, wherein we had no legal or regulatory recourse to do anything to address the threats. Resist AIM decided we will not take no for an answer. We are tired of asking permission of elected officials. We will do it ourselves. We will stop Spectra. We are standing 1.5 miles from the epicenter of this battle. You can look over here to your left and you can see the reactors at Indian Point Nuclear Power Plant. What you cannot see is that right now, Spectra is drilling horizontally under the Hudson River adjacent to this nuclear power plant. Whether or not Indian Point is ever shut down, this is a permanent threat. You know the amount of spent fuel that is stored there. Having a massive 42-inch pipeline right next to it in permanence is a danger to 20 million people in the evacuation radius of this nuclear power plant. So Resist AIM was formed, and we've turned to the tactics that have worked time and time again in social justice and environmental justice, nonviolent direct action and civil disobedience. We are not going to wait for someone else to act. We will act ourselves. I would like, if you have been involved in direct action to stop Spectra, can you please put your hands in the air? If you were arrested, we've had several arrests in this campaign. If you were arrested, please raise your hands. We have the Montrose 9, the Crompon 2, the Broadway 2, and the Verplank 11. These are people that have put themselves on the line to stop this construction right now. We are doing what we are doing what others have said cannot be done, and we are stopping this construction. So if you are a member of Resist, so we've had a number of arrests, but I would like anyone standing here who's a member of Resist AIM to put your hands in the air. And I want everyone else to look around and say, this is the community that is doing the work to stop this pipeline for all of us. For every one of those arrests, there is an army of support personnel behind them that is making this happen. Now, if your hand is in the air, I want you to turn to someone next to you whose hand is not raised, and I want you to ask them to join you. Join us in shutting down this pipeline. You have heard from Delaware, from CPV Power Plant. We've got the Pilgrim Pipeline. We've got the Constitution Pipeline. All of these are projects right here in our neighborhood. It is our job to fight this fight against AIM and stop Spectra here in Westchester, because we are just one piece in a puzzle that stretches across the U.S. of people and communities that are sick of these regulatory agencies doing nothing for communities and doing everything for fossil fuel infrastructure. So I want you to look the people in the eye that are standing around you, and if they've asked you to join us, they've asked you to help us, I want you to do that. And right here, standing with me, is Patrick Robbins. He is a member of Resist AIM. He will use his Wi-Fi hotspot right now to get you to sign the Pledge of Resistance to say that you will stand up and take action to stop Spectra. And once you sign that pledge, we will have a way to contact you. You will get an email, and we will invite you to join our community, attend an orientation, and then get down to business and do the work of stopping this pipeline and protecting Westchester County. So, yes, you can also go to the table out front. There's tons of literature. You can go to our website. We need you. We can shut this pipeline down, but we need your help. It is resistaim.wordpress.com. That is our website. You can also just hashtag Stop Spectra and you can find us. We're all over social media. But we need you. These kids, these are the children of Peekskill. These are the kids that are going to be dealing with the fallout. I hope it's not nuclear fallout, but the fallout of building this pipeline. So we need all of you, everyone standing here today, to join us, to join this community, to take action and stop Spectra. Thank you all for coming out.
Our next group of people are a very interesting group. Earth Guardians has sued the federal government for failure to guarantee their constitutional rights to life, liberty, and a habitable planet for future generations. Three young people from Earth Guardians will be addressing you at this time, and they're going to tell you a little bit about their lawsuit and also about global warming. So I'd like to introduce Rachel Marco Havens, Aidan Ferris, and Iris Gillingham, who will talk about Earth Guardians.
Thank you. What incredible diehards everyone is out here. So amazing. I did write this down because there's so much to say that I couldn't succinctify this in a couple. 18 months ago, I would have laughed if you told me that I'd be here speaking on behalf of public safety in the Hudson Valley, that I would be co-directing Earth Guardians New York, that I would be on the Clearwater Board of Directors. Suddenly I'm an environmental effectivist. If there is a poster child for get up off your ass, I'm it. There is no time for any of us to stay silent. I whether it's on the couch, the meditation cushion, the depths of apathy, wherever you're stuck, obviously you're not those people, but it's time for everyone to step up. And we gotta keep our eyes peeled. We've been called to take responsibility because we're being shown with clarity that our elected and appointed officials do not have public safety in mind. I keep being kind of freaked out by the tricky semantical feng shui that these companies are using. The pilgrims are coming for the indigenous, for the Algonquin land, expressing their dominion by writing their constitution in fossil fuels. What is that? What is that? I live in Woodstock. 90 miles upstate. This is not about a 50-mile fallout radius. This is not about a 90-mile. This is a global issue. And what we're finding, what we found, what this woman found when going to Paris, and what we found in Paris was that we have to come together. It's all about the tiny local actions that build together for global change. It's huge. I'm so proud and so blown away by the work that you're all doing down here. When we started Earth Guardians New York a year ago and saw what was happening down here, we're doing everything we can from up there. We're trying to alert our friends, our family, our neighbors, this community to understand what it is that's happening. 18, 24, 46 hours a day. I know what it's like. We were fighting water extraction up there a year ago, oil extraction, gas extraction, the infrastructures surround it. It takes everything you have to stay working on this. And that's what it is. It's about staying power. We can sign petitions, we can show up at an action or a rally, but it's you who are staying in the game. We all have to act and move like we have skin in the game, because we really all do. And so, sustainability. We keep talking about sustainability like we want to sustain this lifestyle we have, but we need to be thinking about regeneration for the next generations. My grandchildren, your grandchildren, their grandchildren. So, youth empowerment. That's what Earth Guardians are doing, empowering young people. Why? Because when you empower young people, you find solution. Young people see a much bigger picture. My backyard is another man's front yard. My upstream is another man's down. We're all in this. Why youth leadership? Because they're taking it for good reason.
Hey everyone, my name is Aidan Ferris and I'm 21 years old and I'm here to represent the youth, the young people, the kids that were standing on this stage. They were here to represent themselves, and I am so, they're who I'm standing for, because they will be the most affected. My generation and those to follow are the most affected by the decisions that are being made today. So Earth Guardians is an incredible movement of an intergenerational movement of young people, old people, people of all ages, all over the world, standing together in a unified way to say, we're not going to take it anymore. And clearly, we're here. We're not taking it. We're going to fight. We're going to stand up. So we ask people to follow their passions and use their creativity to solve the solutions, and that's why the youth are so powerful, and we can't do it alone. So when I was in Paris at the UN COP21 Paris Agreement, I didn't see a single elected official out there talking to the people. They were all locked behind doors signing papers, and they're not going to be the ones to get us out of this mess. It was the people who were standing outside of the agreements, out there in the cold, the indigenous communities, the frontline communities, the youth. Those are the people who are bringing the solutions. You guys, as a frontline community, are the ones who know what is at stake. We know what is at stake because it's our future. So Earth Guardians is part of a suit that is suing the federal government for not acting on climate change and not protecting our right to a healthy atmosphere. 21 youth from across the U.S. have signed up on this lawsuit, or on this case as plaintiffs, and the people who have signed on with the federal government, guess who that was? That was ExxonMobil. That was the fossil fuel industry. They are with the federal government against 21 kids all under the age of 19 years old. So we are taking them to court because we know that we have the power. We're not going to take it anymore. So we're here and we're so happy to support you, and it's this, I'm so overcome with emotion. Because this is what it's all about, is when people stand together. We're here in the cold, it's freezing, and we're still here because we care, and we know that this is an important fight, and there's nothing else. There's nothing else. We have to do this. There's no other option because of those kids, because of my future, because of Iris.
Hello, everybody. I'm Iris from Earth Guardians Sullivan County, and we as Earth Guardians are here today because we believe in a united action. We believe in being together and taking action together, and that's what we're doing today. This fight is about the pipeline that is coming through this community, but communities everywhere are being invaded by energy extraction. We as youth do not want to be locked into a future of fossil fuel. Yeah. And we are standing up with you. We are rising up for a better future. Thank you.
Yeah. And we will be, in the next month, we'll be coming down here, Aidan, and hopefully Iris and I will come down to do a workshop with local young people who want to join Earth Guardians New York, start an Earth Guardians Westchester, Peekskill. The bigger we are, the more we come together, the bigger we are. So we will support any young people who want to tap in or build.
Okay, folks, this is it. Our last speaker, but last but definitely not least. So please help me welcome Lisa Moir, who is founder extraordinaire of Croton Climate Initiative, and also the organizer for Peekskill to Paris rally that took place right here back in November and brought out a great crowd in terrible weather as the climate talks were starting in Paris. Where's Lisa? There she is. And one more very important fact is Lisa is the purveyor of the Blue Pig, the most delicious local organic ice cream east of the Mississippi, so make sure you stop there. It's in Croton. But I want to welcome Lisa. She's amazing, and she has very important action steps for all of you to take. Don't go home without hearing what Lisa has to say, and thank you so much.
It's the curse of the Peekskill rally, this cold. I'm sorry I brought it with me. So what can we do, people? What can we do? Or perhaps more specifically, what can you do? After hearing all these speakers, we can be even more frustrated than ever that the systems around us are broken. So what is the answer?
Set it down.
The answer is action. Taking action enables you to feel powerful in a seemingly powerless situation. Like the domino effect, when you push one block, like it or not, the other ones are going to be affected. And taking action creates new movement in a system that is goddamn stuck. Stopping this pipeline is going to take real action on our part. The days of signing petitions and clicking like on Facebook are over. Yeah. They don't work. No. Democracy requires involvement. It requires involvement. Voting is just an event, but democracy is a process. And we are part of that process. Thinking our government and the corporations that control it are going to work for our interests while we sit back doesn't work, people. That's what's part of gotten us here. We've been relaxed and quiet and thinking that someone else is watching over our best interests. It's not happening. So we need to heed the words of our next president, Bernie Sanders. Yeah! It's time for us to take back our government and elicit our own power in controlling and putting our voices into action. So you will need to decide when you leave here, what is your action? Yeah. It's different for all of us. But we all have the power to do something. Whether it be civil disobedience, political pressure, umpteen phone calls and marches, local or national, join the board, volunteer on a committee, go to your town meetings, write an op-ed, ask questions and demand the answers. It all matters. Look at your consumption. We cannot have this conversation without talking about our own consumption. personally, in your family, and in your business. You can have a home energy audit, and like me, if you own your own business, or for those of you that work, you can talk to the people in your own business and get your business to be involved in green certification, like the Blue Pig, one of 10 businesses in all of Westchester that is a certified green business. We're all making choices every day. We made the choice to come here. Now it's time to make the choice to go home and take this with you. The flyers that SAPE has here have action steps, political action steps. If you're gonna make one phone call, make 10 phone calls. What I've done is hang out with a friend. It's a lot easier when you do it with someone else. So instead of just having coffee and talking about the kids and making plans to go out to dinner, have coffee and get your cell phone. And for 10 minutes, make phone calls. You can even leave a message. And most of the time, that's all you need to do. As far as Resist AIM, the members are here. Believe me, they need a helping hand. Not everyone needs to get arrested, but for every person that gets arrested, there's 20 people that need to support them. Whether it's grabbing a cup of coffee for them, or standing on the sidelines with a sign, or just calling someone and letting them know that you'll pick them up later. You can all do something. So if you want to stop this pipeline, it's time to push back. And push back hard. Thank you. Let's give a last round of applause for Paula, who put this day together, and thanks for braving the storm here. Thanks, Paula.
I just want to thank you for coming, and if you didn't get an information sheet on action steps to take to try to stop this pipeline from SAPE, please stop at the table and pick one up. And thanks again. We need all your support. And okay, so thank you. Bye.